today is Mayuresh Joshi of William O'Neill. Thanks so much for joining me this morning, Mayuresh. Good morning to you. And the market seemed to be heading to a close in 2020 that I think most people had not predicted or would not have predicted. But, you know, that's a conversation perhaps for another day. Let me ask you about the first stock on my list, which is AU Small Finance Bank. And the reason I'm asking you about this is that it has gotten into a partnership with ICICI Prudential Life Insurance. And this is primarily to, deliver ICICI Prudential's suite of products to its customers, both through its digital platform as well as through its various touch points. Now, this, I think, Mayuresh, is why these banks were set up in the first place and given their licenses in the first place. How do you think that this is going to benefit AU Small Finance Bank? Or in fact, would you buy into that company or would you rather prefer the partnership or the partner that is ICICI Prudential Life Insurance?
Good morning, Alex. Thanks for having me on your show. I think as the news pointed out, it is obviously very, very positive because it gives a diversification stream for AU Finance Bank in terms of life products that it can cross-sell database. It's also positive for insurer as well because they're always looking at channels to expand their reach. Insurance as a space, I think, highly underpenetrated, and there is a huge, huge potential over the next 5 to 10 years, specifically in the aftermath of the pandemic. But coming specifically to AU, I think it's obviously a sentimentally positive set of news. And again, piggyback riding in terms of their existing infrastructure should aid the other income growth as well. Having said that, I think the kind of numbers that we saw in the first half and the recovery in the second quarter, specifically in terms of the collection efficiencies moving higher as the unlock phase started getting back on track and the disbursements coming back to normalization levels as well. I think those key factors played positively in terms of the numbers that they had presented. Net interest margin stood around 5.3%. ROEs have always been good for EU, so around 1.7% and around 16.1%. GNPAs and net NPAs under control, so at 1.5.5 respectively, and with provision coverage exceeding that 70% mark and capital adequacy at 21%. I think it's a very, very healthy state that AU Small Finance is at this point of time. Earnings will take its time because of the impact that we've seen because of the pandemic. So our own EPS ratings are suggesting that they should see an up move going forward, which should get reflected in the price strength as well. So yeah, I think it's a very interesting proposition. I think AU looks adequately placed in terms of a good price move, at least on O'Neill parameters. EPS ratings, RS ratings are a little bit on the softer side, but the expectations in terms of improvement going forward can have momentum in the stock. So yeah, I think momentum traders or investors can probably have a look at that. But again, as our methodology goes, I think keep a strong watch out for the PDM.
Understood. And there is seemingly room for it to grow, like you were pointing. Which brings me to the second stock, Mayuresh. It's Cochin Shipyard. And it is going to consider, the board is going to consider in another few days an interim dividend. That really is a trigger for me to talk to you. But I want to talk to you about the fundamentals as well, considering that we are seeing an improvement in economic activity. Is this really a company to watch out for in the port space? I mean, in the shipyard space?
So interesting, again, because of the... it had a very soft set of numbers in Q2. But again, I think it's coming back to normalization levels. I think the EBITDA margin had a huge amount of contraction, even though the gross margins actually expanded because of negative operating leverage. And therefore, I think the expectations largely from the two divisions that it works out of, shipbuilding and ship repairs, I think it needs to be very, very interestingly pointing out that as more orders start coming through, and if ship repairs is something to be believed is a higher margin order, the kind of a business within that segment itself, I think the margin should show some signs of stability as well. So reasonable amount of order book, the management is expecting that they can get almost 15,000 to 20,000 crore, something in that range, from the Navy and the Coast Guard itself, specifically when it comes to the shipbuilding part. But again, I think... healthy cash on their balance sheets in excess of 1,400 odd crores, a healthy dividend payout that probably gets exhibited as well. An expectation, again, as I said, of margins being maintained between 18-19% reflecting in ROEs actually coming back, because this year it might come down in those higher single digits, 10 9-10% odd, but can bounce back very, very sharply. So again, similar to AU Small, as has been the case with the pandemic, I think the EPS ratings, RS ratings are a little bit soft because of these factors, but they are expected to show signs of improvement. So if they're able to execute well, I think there is no doubt that cash flows will remain strong, and with a healthy balance sheet, dividend payouts should also remain strong. So yeah, anybody holding on as per our O'Neill ratings can very well hold on to the stock.
All right. And, you know, I've been looking at the delivery data over the past few days, and there are a few counters that have emerged with very strong delivery data. This Orient Refractories, Mahiresh, in yesterday's session was unusually high, and there was quite a lot of delivery buying in this counter. It gained over 7%, very strong buying. What really do you think is buzzing in the stock? Is there anything that is fundamentally driving this run-up?
So two ways to look at this, Alex. One, in terms of how the positioning for these refractory players are, and they're largely dependent in terms of how the steel industry functions to a large extent, because that's where the majority of their business comes from. If you look at steel management commentaries, Q2 has been exceptional, and what they're pointing out specifically from the next couple of quarters perspective is that demand is expected to remain extremely, extremely strong. So with the burgeoning demand and expectations of price hikes that they've taken, the need for refractories actually starts moving higher. Now, there was an interview that I was reading a few months back, Alex, and it's pertinent to point that out. The management of JSW Steel also pointed out, specifically in terms of the clashes that we had with China, where a major emphasis in terms of our imports of refractories comes from, both in terms of inputs and the finished goods as well, of having larger dependence of local refractory players for the steel making process. So if you divide the industry locally, I think Orient, IFGL and Vesuvius, I think they are the three players that probably are within the space itself. But if you stack up numbers of all of these three put together, yes, top line has been constricted for Orient and players like Vesuvius, but the operating profit margins are far better for Orient compared to the others, around 16-17%. The net profit margins also in double digits. Debt equity, not that high. In fact, almost a debt-free company, which means that the ROEs are also significantly higher compared to the other two players as well. So interesting times. I think refractory players are probably in the sweet spot at this point of time. Expectations of earnings improvement, cash flows improvement, and EPS ratings going higher probably seems to be with the sector, as the steel sector also is expected to do well. Yeah, so it fits our only ratings in terms of all these factors moving very, very well, and the momentum can very well continue. So yeah, there can be a good potential upside for a stock like Orient Refractories. But again, I think your stop loss has to be very, very close to that 50 DMMR, which you very, very closely follow.
Interesting, right, Mahiresh? In the market as it stands today, we've got three stocks that have potential, reasonable potential upside based on your methodology. Thanks so much for joining me today and for taking the time.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And to you, dear viewers, it was an interesting conversation. Do let us know what you think in the comment section on any one of our social media platforms.